Welcome to Board Game Publisher. The format for today's video will be a bit different as I'm trying to analyze the current state of the board game market. As you most probably have noticed already, since the last few decades, the number of board games that are available on the market, the number of new releases, the number of new publishers has been steadily rising, and we are now to a point where the number of new releases is reaching about 5,000 new games per year. This is absolutely huge, and it calls for an analysis of the market and to assess how, as board game publisher, we can address this. Is this an issue? Is this a good thing? And how do we as board game publisher change our marketing practices and our maybe release schedule to adapt to that kind of market? So let's start first with some history. If we look back to the 1980s until 1995, 1998, it's not a fixed date, but that is what I would call the pre-internet age. Technologically, at the time, it was harder to publish games. It was still manual typesetting. Desktop publishing only came after that. And only few people had the skills and the technical know-how to be actually able to publish a game and to go from the idea to the product and to give something to the manufacturer that the manufacturer could actually process to release the game. If you look at the community of gamers in the 80s and 90s, it was not necessarily easy to find gamers outside your local community. You had to look at the school, the church, the local store, maybe a local community of gamers, and it was not always easy to find a lot of different gamers that had the same interest as you did. Production-wise, there were only a few manufacturers that were available, and not everyone knew about it. Some publishers did produce their game themselves. In the States, actually many board game publishers still call themselves manufacturers, even though they do not manufacture the game themselves, but the term has stayed because there was a time where you could not just go to a factory with all the design and just ask them to produce the game for you. So this was something that was all of an adventure in itself, getting the game produced. Marketing-wise, publisher made use of magazines, paper ads, and it was a niche product, board games. It still is, but it's reaching now a much more wider audience, and marketing is easier now. But at the time, marketing was quite specific. Conventions were still small, relatively again. And getting the game on your retailer shelf was an adventure in itself. The distribution system was quite complex, and you had to get some contact and to learn about it, and it was quite hard to do so. So that was the pre-internet period from the 80s to the 90s, and at the time the number of new releases was still quite low. I would say about 1,000 games per year. My source for this is Board Game Geek, if I look at the releases, and just the new games, not the extension. So new titles up to 1,000, it was still moderate at that time. Then the second period is what I would call the internet period. So end of the 90s, start of the 2000s, I would say from 1998 to 2004 about. We still see the number of new releases going from 1,000 to 1,500, but great advances were made in these few years. First, internet was becoming much more common. People were getting internet at home and not only at school or at the office. And also internet speed was rising and new services were coming. If you look at the technology of publishing board game at the time, computer to plate, digital printing, prepress, and desktop publishing were major new advances at that time. There was what I called the Photoshop games era. It was much easier for anyone with a good idea and some technical know-how to put together everything that is needed to produce a game that would look good on the shelves, that was up to the rest of the market. The technical aspect were becoming more of a formality. So anyone with a good idea can try, make a product, and have the tool, access to the tool to make it. That's a big change. The access to the tool and the professional desktop publishing and prepress. Internet also bring international payments in a much more easier manner. It was the beginning of PayPal and stuff like that. If you look at the community of gamer, well, the world was becoming very fast a global village. It was easier than ever to connect with other people, and you could start to find other people that share the same interest that you did, and not just the people that were living around you. So you could connect with a lot of people through internet, and you could start also to see things like Craigslist, Board Game Geek, Meetup, and stuff like that, that made it much easier as well to communicate and to connect with other gamers. If you could look at the production of game into the, as I said again, late 90s, early 2000s, production was becoming easier. You could, thanks to internet again, connect with Chinese manufacturer and with European manufacturer, and also manufacturer were starting to get more orders to go bigger and to be present on internet. So it was becoming much more easier as well to connect with the manufacturer. Marketing did not change a lot at the time. Specialized magazines, paper ads, a growth in convention, of course. And getting the game on the retailer shelf was still difficult, and distribution was still kind of a dark art. It was easier to get connected with distributors, of course, and the volumes were getting higher as well, but it was still complex to get in. In 2004, Facebook, that was a big, big change. And just after the rise of Facebook, if you look at 2004 to 2009, you see that the number of games released each year rose from 1,500 to 2,500. Still, sourced from BGG and the games without the extensions, just the new releases. If we look at that period, 2004 to 2009, technically, it was now possible for anyone with a modicum of technological know-how and tech savvy to be able to prepare a professional product and to get assistance to make a professional product. PayPal was no longer a novelty, so e-commerce was something that was becoming acceptable for a lot of people. They would start to use their credit card to order stuff from the internet. Mail order was not the only option anymore. You could start a website and just start selling stuff through PayPal. Community-wise, Facebook made it tremendously easy to find people who shared the same interest as you did. And that was really a key also in the growth of new releases and in the growth of the number of players and the growth of the market overall. More player groups were becoming available, and also as a consequence of that, if more people plays, you see more designers, more people have been playing the games, and they started to think, hey, I could design a board game of my own, and more people, of course, becoming publishers as well. So that's a big change, and Facebook was, I think, a key aspect in the evolution of the market over the years. The production was becoming easier than ever. It was really easy now to connect with Chinese and European manufacturers. Marketing-wise, it's still the same old specialized magazines, paper ads, growth of the conventions, and more direct contact with the gamers and with the retailers than ever. That's also thanks to Facebook and thanks to Board Game Geek and other internet sites. But now that internet is something that is really into the day-to-day of everyone, we saw that the marketing has started to change with that. So 2004 to 2009, that's really the internet era. Distribution access as well was becoming easier because it was just easier to connect to people through internet. The next step, if we look at it in 2009, is of course the Kickstarter. Kickstarter, if you look at it, there is really a before and an after Kickstarter. The number of new releases per year after Kickstarter rose from 2,500 per year to 4,500 per year. So if we look at the last 2 years, we have shy under 5,000 releases per year. That is huge. And so in a few years of time, We've come from 1,000 releases per year to 5,000 releases per year. That's a huge, huge, huge change, a huge amount, a huge number of new games. And you may have heard the term the tsunami of new releases. It's a tidal wave of cardboard coming to the retailer shelves. So Kickstarter has been changing the financing aspect completely, and that was one of the last barriers to entry, finding the money to be able to publish your first game. With Kickstarter, it was now easier than ever. Community-wise, we see more gamers and more designers than ever, of course, and we also see the different releases evolving. It's becoming much more like book. So you know that board games are a product of the mind. It's a cultural product, and if you look at books, you have a lot of different genres in literature. You have the romance books, you have the thrillers, you have horror style, you have non-fiction, you have a lot of different kind of books, and we see that coming in board games as well. You see genres appearing and different publishers specializing in specific genres, some of them doing essentially a game with miniatures, other doing games that are party games, other that are specializing in games that have you look for different things together and not just pitting you against each other. Of course, the Eurogames genre and niche, I would say, is becoming very large with a lot of people that like this game, very present on the internet, and so giving that that kind of game a huge boost in visibility. Which does not necessarily equal to the market size. The games that are most sold and most played overall remain the family game and the party game. Never forget that. But community is becoming larger, more game coming, thanks to Kickstarter. Production becomes also easier than ever because with the huge influx of new publishers coming to manufacturers, thanks to Kickstarter, the manufacturers have started to change the way they address that as well. They started to publish teaching resources, guides, manuals, and also some of the manufacturers, such as Panda, which is a very good example of that, have also started doing more surveys, not just give us the file and we will produce a product, but you have a sales rep, someone that will handhold you, that will provide training if necessary, so that you can easier provide a good set of files to the manufacturer to release the product. So that was an evolution that is a direct consequence of the Kickstarter. Marketing-wise, it's a mixed bag. Kickstarter is two things. It's a financing tool and it's a marketing tool. And it's more easier than ever with Kickstarter to show your game to a lot of people that you would not have reached otherwise because there is a platform effect. So that's a very good thing. But at the same time, with the number of new releases and the number of new projects of Kickstarter, there is a lot of noise, and it's harder than ever to exist in all of that noise and to be noticed. So if there are 100 new games this week on Kickstarter, why would people back my game rather than another one? So it brings on a new set of problems. We see that YouTube, Instagram, and other channels are used more and more for marketing as well. That's also an evolution. We also see that there is some specialization and ancillary services that come, and that really developed a lot with the advent of Kickstarter. We see content creators, reviewers, we have previews of the game before they are released on Kickstarter, we have reviews once the game is released, we have the different channels that are only speaking about game, and all of these channels have a lot of followers. So that's also a different kind of way to reach the gamers, to reach the players, to reach the retailers, and also to get noticed by distributors. So that's something really different as well. If you look at distribution, there is a change also because all of these new releases end up on the distributor door, and the distributor the distributor have changed the way they address that. They are becoming more picky. They will not take all of the game and see what sells. They will say, okay, this I will take, this I will not take. So, and the time also where a distributor was getting all of the new games of a given publisher, no question asked, is over. Now you have really to work hand in hand with the distributor from the conception of the product to the finished product if you want to have a very good chance of your product to be distributed. That's a good thing in many ways, but it's harder to get into distribution. So that makes the market different. It might not be a bad thing because also the sales are changing a lot. People buy on Amazon, people buy direct on the publisher website, people buy at the retailer through distribution. So we have a lot of channels that are existing now. People buy on Kickstarter, of course. And all of the various channels that exist are not as concurrent as they were before. Now, as a board game publisher, if I have a very specific game, I can say, okay, this is a game that should go to distribution and retail because it's formatted for that. Or this is a niche game and I will only sell it direct on my board, on my website. Or this is a product where I'm not sure on what or who the market is for. I have my idea, of course, but I have to validate that against the market, and for that, Kickstarter is a very good tool. As you can see, since the 80s, the market has tremendously evolved, and this is thanks to a few very noticeable technological advances. And this is actually not something that is specific to the board game industry. Most people in the board game industry say, it's because of Kickstarter, it's specific to board games, we have a problem, we have to handle this, there are way too much releases. Actually, this has happened in other markets as well. If we look at other markets, we will see that it's a kind of pattern. So we have a lower bar to entry. It's becoming easier and easier to produce, to be a player in the market. This is ensued by, of course, a huge rise in new releases, and usually it also derives from technological disruption of the market. Something new has been developed, new technologies are available that lower the barrier to access and that allow that saturation and that explosion of new releases on the market. So, let's look at a few other industries. Let's look at books. Books are nothing new, of course. They are with us till the Middle Ages, and even before that, if you look at manuscripts. But there has been also a huge, huge increase in releases with books on the last 10, 15, 20 years. It's also thanks to internet. If you look, the internet sales of book has been a very important aspect. Amazon has been building an empire on that. And also the advent of electronic books, e-books. That's something that makes the barrier to entry very much lower. You also have print on demand. So when you want to print a book, you do not have to print pallets of them and hope they sell. It's very much possible today to just upload your files on Amazon, and then when people order the book, it's printed just for that order and sent to the customer. This is nothing short of revolutionary. We have integrated that in our day-to-day, but that's a huge technological advance. So books is a market in which technological advance has made the barrier to entry lower and much more new releases. And we see the number of books released each year is also on a meteoric rise at the moment. If we look at music, same thing with MP3s, streaming, and the ease of use of computer music tools, digital audio workstation, and music production has become much easier than ever. Distribution of music has become easier than ever with MP3 and streaming. And so that's a market that has been affected by that as well. Another example would be European comics, with a lot of new publishers, as edition and printing has become cheaper and selling has become easier as well. And we saw into the Belgian comics and the French comics a huge amount of new releases into the 2000 and 2010s. That was possible thanks also to internet and new tools that made it much easier for the sale and the release of these books. Another example would be role-playing games. Role-playing games, if you look at role-playing games into the 90s and 2000s, before the market was almost crushed by the arrival of Magic the Gathering and the collectible games, RPGs have survived with D20 and with PDF, and then with internet. So now it's easier than ever to publish a role-playing game. You could go electronic only, just sell PDFs on DriveThruRPG and sites like that. It's very, very easy. It's very low barrier to entry. And if you look at the number of new releases in board game, in role-playing game, it is astounding. The number of new releases that we have today in role-playing game, it's huge. It's just huge. And of course, the elephant in the room is video games. Video games has seen a very similar evolution than we have in board game. You had Steam with the green light, and then the Steam as distribution platform open to everyone. This is very similar to what happened in the board game industry with Kickstarter. So it's easier than ever to publish a video game now and to distribute it to a very wide audience. So as you can see, this is not unique to board games. The amount of new releases is something that we see rising in other cultural products. And it's always the same pattern. We have technological disruption, something new becomes available, the barrier to entry gets lower, the distribution gets easier, the production gets easier, and as a consequence, the market is just exploding. This has huge consequences as a board game publisher in the way that you produce and market your games. You have to be careful about the number of games that you will produce and at the way you will be selling them. So I will stop this video here for today, and I will prepare a second video in which I will review other markets that have been affected by the same kind of explosion and see how they have coped with that, because some of these markets, such as video games or music, have been hit, I would say, by this phenomena before board games, and they have coped with it and they have found solutions for this. And so there are most certainly, as board game publisher, lessons to be learned from what happened in other markets. As usual, if you found this interesting, hit the like button. If you don't like it, hit the dislike button. And make sure to leave a comment and say what you didn't like or what you think I'm wrong in what I'm saying, because I do not hold the truth. I may be wrong. So I'm interested. Please leave a comment and let me know.